Thanks to Fossil's Hybrid HR Smartwatch for sponsoring this video. So there's a lot of important questions you have to ask yourself throughout your life. But perhaps the most important one right now, in the tech space at least, is to flip or to fold. And that might be a question that maybe you don't have the answer to right now, or maybe a question you don't want to ask yourself, but it might be one that you are asking sooner rather than later. So in that vein, there's two new Samsung phones out. Probably didn't see that one coming. We're talking about the Z Flip 3 and sort of comparing it to the Z Fold 3. That could be a traditional versus where sort of put these two phones head to head and see which one kind of comes out on top. Instead, I'm gonna talk about each one, pros and cons, kind of mini review style of both, which version I prefer, but ultimately kind of help you guys decide which one you should get, because these two phones are crazy compelling, but I think for very different people. So, flip or fold. So if you've been watching any of my videos recently, you know I generally like to start off versus videos with a blind camera test. But instead of just a flip and the fold, I'm throwing in a wild card this time. How about Samsung's S21 to see how Samsung's newest offering stack up against a phone that came out like 8-ish months ago, at least by the time I'm filming this. So here are some pictures. Do some look more saturated to you? Do some look less saturated to you? How do color reproduction look? How do highlights, low lights? How does sky and clouds look? How does my face look? How do sort of details in general look in these pictures? Do you have any guess which is which? So, A is the flip, B is the fold, and C is the S21. Did you get it right? I'm guessing you didn't. There's a lot of similarities, obviously, between these camera systems. That was really the whole point. And that's why I think this generation of flippy and foldy phones are especially interesting and intriguing. When you come to the flip side, when that phone came out essentially last year, it was rocking what was essentially the Galaxy S10's camera setup instead of the S20, which was the other phone Samsung had out. To my eye, the pictures that came out of the foldable 2 didn't stack up as well to the pictures that came out of the S21. And maybe it's an internal bias in my head, and it was a very small margin, but I generally prefer the photos that came out of the S21, and I don't know why that is from a processing standpoint, a hardware standpoint, they should have been close to identical. The good news, especially when it comes to camera stuff, is that could likely be fixed or addressed with software. Or maybe I'm totally wrong. In your eyes, the foldy guys look way better, and you're like, John, you are a nutso human being. So things do get different when it comes to selfie cameras, specifically on the Z Fold 3, which I'm just gonna call the Fold. Just know I'm talking about the Fold 3. I'm gonna say the Flip, Z Flip 3, I'm talking about the Flip. So Samsung has tried their hand at hiding the camera cutout. And they kind of did it, but also kind of didn't. From an aesthetic standpoint, I didn't mind it. The quality of the photos that came out were a little bit hazy and not as good, I think, as you'd expect from that regular selfie camera, but it almost doesn't matter with the Fold. And that's why I think Samsung actually made the right choice to try something new here. I'm saying selfie camera, perhaps disingenuously. I think I could probably describe that more as like the video chatting camera. Because the phone folds, you can actually use almost any of the other cameras to take selfies, which is absolutely awesome. Use the front display as your viewfinder, so you don't have to hold that giant thing out to take your selfie. So you have a lot of options. So if Samsung has all those options, they're able to take a camera sensor that they probably knew wasn't gonna have the same quality and able to experiment with it. And I am all for those experimentations. That's been what these fold lines have always been about. Trying new things, refining them, and ultimately making them better and better until they become great and make their way downstream. So it's not a great camera, but for your Zoom and Duo, whatever else you wanna do with it, is totally fine. Okay, so just rounding out the camera thing here quickly. If overall you're looking for the best cameras that Samsung has to offer, then it's the S21 Ultra, obviously. It's the Ultra, it's the best options. However, if you're not looking for every photo to be award-winning, you don't want a ginormous zoom, you just wanna have a reliable camera that's going to work well, and work well on most occasions, and quite frankly, you can't go wrong, either the Flip or the Fold. And that is awesome to say, because that was clearly not the case last year, and is a giant step forward for Samsung, addressing an issue they had with their phones and fixing it with the next one. So, Flippy versus Foldy, is one better than the other? Yeah, but I think it's gonna depend who you ask. So before we get into who I think each one is for, kind of want to go over some of the changes that were made that might sort of change your opinion of these phones. A lot of people have very strong opinions on these phones and have never held them before. So start the flip. The biggest change and the most obvious one that Samsung had to make was that tiny little baby screen on the outside. Now, I still would have liked it to be larger, and I think the roadmap for it being larger is going to happen next year. But it's bigger now, and that's awesome. Not only is it bigger, it is more usable. You have more information on it, it's dynamic, you can change what it can do, you can scroll on it, you can interact with stuff. It's great for a lot of people. For me, it was mostly just to see who was calling, and then I would open the phone up. I didn't like to do that many things on the outside because it's still a small screen. And by the time I'm swiping and scrolling, it's easier for me just to open up and do what I want to do and then just close it. Now, I might be in the minority there. My friend Michael Fisher, you may know him as Mr. Mobile, was on our podcast talking about this, and he used that outer screen quite a bit. So your use case might vary. I found myself generally just opening it up and using it like a regular phone much more than actually interacting with that little screen on the outside. Speaking of outside screens and changes need to be made, the Fold got a nice upgrade. So a really tall boy, 7.6 inch screen. Typing on it still feels cramped because it's really narrow, but it is definitely can be done, easy to do. You get full app access. Essentially, it's just like a really tall, regular phone, and the launcher treats it like a totally different home screen. So you can customize the outer screen versus the inside screen. Perhaps the best part, that outer screen now is 120 hertz. And you know how I feel about my high refresh screens. And that's pretty much the theme for all the screens on both of these phones, except for the little baby one on the outside of the Flip. Every screen, every big screen at least, is 120 hertz, which is absolutely awesome. I've been a real unabashed fan of Samsung's Galaxy Fold line since the very first one ultimately ended up getting recalled. It felt like holding the future. And it's always felt like holding the future. But it felt like holding a very, very delicate, petrified to drop it or have an ounce of water fall on it future. You had to baby how you use these phones for the first two generations. Samsung, to their credit, has fixed a lot of those issues. Now it came, I think, at the expense of perhaps a redesign and making the phone physically look different. It looks essentially the same if you sort of have the two and the three next to each other, but that doesn't tell the whole story. We've got a really solid IP ranking now where this phone could essentially be submerged in water. And you think that just a few months ago, if it rained, you had to head for the hills if you're using a Z Fold 2. That's amazing. Durability all around is improved. And that, again, was a huge flaw with the Z Fold 2. So I commend Samsung. And I think I probably have some, much as I try to push it down, some bias of just really liking foldable devices. So take everything I'm saying here with that grain of salt. But I do want to give a lot of credit again to Samsung for addressing those issues. Now, I would have liked if those dressing of issues came with the price point going downwards, but you can see how they are improving these phones, and I think that's awesome. And they sort of did similar refinements with the Z Flip 3. You've got an IP ranking at least on it right now. It's not submergible, but you know, if I walk through a sprinkler, you don't have to cover it and hold it and run, which is something that actually has happened to me. The biggest comments that I always see about foldables is the crease in there. I'm gonna wait till there's no crease. I'm not gonna use the phone with the crease. The crease is ugly, the crease is horrible, your face is dumb. They sort of range through some version of that. I'm here to tell you that first of all, the crease is not going away in a foldable display because glass cannot physically fold and then open back up again, unless you wanna go with what Microsoft did with the Duo with two separate screens. The crease is here. It has not for a second ever bothered me on any of these foldable devices. As somebody who has used foldable devices now for a few years, There's a lot of things to worry about with them. The crease is not one of them. It is still equally as visible though on the Z Fold 3 as it was on the first generation. The same thing with the Flippy Boy. Again, I don't notice it at all, and I don't think that should factor into your decision making. One thing that should factor into your decision is definitely going to be battery life, specifically for the Flip. Don't get me wrong, the Fold's battery life isn't like world record setting. The battery life on the Flip though is just not great. There's no way around it. I was able to stretch it for a day, but if you are a moderate to heavy user, you're going to want to charge this phone. It will charge up to 25 watts, so not like the fastest charging out there, unfortunately, but certainly not the slowest, but I would keep some sort of charging brick with you throughout the day. So traditional smartwatches definitely have their place, but they are far from perfect. First, they look like little screens on your wrist, and almost all of them have battery life that leaves a lot to be desired. Enter Fossil, that has a watch that I think bridges the gap between traditional watch and smartwatch, and does it by looking really good. So meet the Hybrid HR. Before I tell you about it, the one thing that you really need to know, 2 week battery life, which is absolutely amazing and astounding in a watch that is doing a lot of things. So looking at it, you can see that it is not your traditional smartwatch. It's combining the best of a regular watch plus a smartwatch with an e-ink display. But with that e-ink display, you're still getting a lot of core smartwatch stuff with the looks and ability to tell time of like a regular, you know, normal watch with the hands. So a lot of cool things this can do. First, it'll work with iOS or Android absolutely perfectly. The HR stands for heart rate. So obviously you've got the heart rate monitor in there. It can track things like steps. You can manually check your heart rate, even has workout sensors built in. And when you push the buttons, this is probably my favorite feature, the hands will realign themselves so you can see what is on the display. So if it's like 12 o'clock, you're not gonna be blocking the weather. So there are two sizes available. There's a 38 and a 42 millimeters. So you can pick depending on your wrist size. If you want the best of what a smartwatch offers, so the biometrics, the workout sensing, weather, it's sort of information at a glance, but you still want it to look like a traditional watch. The Fossil Hybrid HR bridges that gap really well and looks awesome doing it. If you want to learn more about what the Fossil Hybrid HR watch can do, and I think you should, or even pick one up for yourself, we'll put a link to it down below. So like to again, rewind a little bit to the very first Fold, there were issues with it. People were peeling off screen protectors. There was dust and dirt getting under the screen. Even when it got fixed and came out again, there were still problems. And a lot of those problems persisted through Gen 2, which I think made the Fold really for enthusiasts. Those that were willing to pay a premium to kind of help Samsung develop in the open, and they got the privilege of a really cool device. Now, the price is still very, very expensive for the Z Fold 3, but I do think those issues that plagued the first two, especially hinge-related issues, appear to have been addressed. And again, still expensive, I don't think this device is any longer for just enthusiasts. This is a phone that appears to be ready for anyone that's willing to sort of pay the dollar amount to get it. The Flip is probably an even better example of this. So now bringing the price point, well, in all fairness, reducing the storage size to $999, that's pretty much on par with the Galaxy S21. So now you can choose what form factor you want and you're paying the same price for it. That is amazing, that is awesome. And I think that the Flip is gonna be a phone that a lot of people go to as their first foldable display. And the giant caveat, the elephant in the room, when it comes to price, especially with Samsung devices, is that their trade-ins that they offer are nutso. So good, and at least as of right now, like you can stack your trade-ins. So if you've got like an old LG Velvet, maybe you've got an S10, you could stack those suckers up on the trade-in side and get amazing credits back. I mean, to really take the cost of either the Fold or the Flip down to almost nothing. It is amazing if you thought these phones were too expensive or you wanted to go through the carrier and do a payment plan, just check out Samsung's trade-ins, because if you got any phone laying in a drawer, it might be worth a lot more than you think. So now I think that we've established, at least in my head, that the Fold is ready for anybody who wants to pay the price for it. And the Flip is insanely accessible as a foldable. Like, who are both of those for? And what are the use cases? So as a Fold purist, here's who I think the new Fold is for. It is for anybody who is really wishing they had a tablet with them, doesn't want to carry a tablet and a phone. If that's you, then, and you can afford it, you get the Fold and do not think twice. I also think the Fold is for those that are looking to switch away from Apple. I think this is a phone that offers something so much different than a new rectangle that we've seen as a brand new form factor. And aside from OS preference, there's new use cases, new things you can do that you just couldn't do with an iPhone. Being able to see something on the outer screen and open it up and have it bigger is an amazing experience. It almost seems like magic. So to anybody who wants a larger screen but doesn't want to sacrifice the outer display, still wants to have amongst the best camera system going, wants to be able to now use an S Pen, which is a giant step forward as well for the Fold, then that's you. If you're a multitasker, you wanna do a lot of things on your phone, you wanna take one device with you when you travel, then don't hesitate. I can recommend the Z Fold 3 to absolutely anybody and everyone. It is amazing, it does things differently, and it plays to the best strengths of Android because you have choice on what you want it to do. This is a new form factor, and you can only get that right now with Android. And you have choice on what you want and which form factor you want, and that is awesome. When it comes to the Flip, I've always loved that the Flip existed, but it wasn't the phone for me. That's changed a lot with the new generation and the Z Flip 3. First, there's like 2.5 generations of people that have not experienced just the sheer joy of hanging up a phone call by closing it. I don't wanna undersell that or oversell it too much, but that is awesome. Being able to answer a phone by opening it up is really cool. And now you've got a really small form factor. And they've done some really cool stuff with it too. You can fold it halfway, you can sort of put it into a table mode, and you could use it for video chatting and have your hands free. It gives you a lot of awesome things in a really smaller form factor. And you get that without sacrificing really anything. Maybe some IP rankings that you have with the S21. I now think that this is a phone I can recommend to absolutely anybody. You want a smaller phone? This is for you. You wear tight pants? This is for you. You want to keep your phone in a purse? This phone's for you. You want a cool new form factor? This phone's for you. This phone is for almost anybody. And it's at an affordable price point, relatively speaking, in the phone pantheon. And I think it's awesome and amazing. And this is like a tough one for me to say because I love the Fold so much and I think I would love to have both. But on a day-to-day basis, I think I would probably use the Flip and I think I'd be really happy with it. And if I was traveling and I wanted to just carry one device and not carry a tablet, I would go back to the Fold. I'm not doing as much multitasking as I used to because I'm not really going anywhere right now. But for sort of the sitting on your couch doing normal stuff, the Fold is still great, but the Flip has something about it. It's got gravitas, which I can't describe. And I can't necessarily say, but if you've held one or go to a store or wherever you can see one and experience opening this thing up and closing it, it is immensely satisfying. It's not perfect. I wish the outer screen was bigger. I wish the IP ranking was better. I wish it worked with the S Pen and all of that stuff. But this is sort of the ultimate plan of foldables finally coming to fruition. It's at an affordable price point with very few sacrifices, and that's awesome. I've always loved foldables because I think of what they represent for the future. In order to get to Gen 3, you gotta get through the first few gens, and what we have right now is a device that's pretty much for everybody. It might not be the perfect phone for everyone, but it's gonna give someone, and almost everyone, something new, something to be excited about when it comes to the world of phones. And in a marketplace where we've got generally different rectangles with moderately improved features, now we got a brand new shape to get excited about. I think for 2021 and 2022, it's all about the square.